motion. And then if the uniform wasn't perfect, then they sent that soldier into the cold water, and then they made him, with his wet uniform, roll on the beach, and he's covered in sand. And then they had to stay like that the whole day. I guess. When I hear stuff like that, my mind goes, forget it. No way. So, there was no question that I was going to submit voluntarily to something like that. Rather, I was ready to do anything to avoid the draft, which eventually worked out. I've officially been declared insane. But anyway, I got the stamp and the paper, and thank God I made it out of the army. It was a clash between my individual nature and society. I kind of always held my individual freedom in high esteem, and therefore they offered me a few topics tonight, and one was about being, how to balance spiritual and material life. And I said, don't ask me how to balance things, because that's not my strong point. My life is not about being balanced. That's not my nature. My nature is to be on the cutting edge, right? And that doesn't always make it balanced, but it sort of makes it exciting. And that's what inspires me. So I'm someone ready to push himself, adventurous spirit, ready to push himself beyond limits, sometimes a bit too much, I would say. But, so far, so good. Okay, that's a little bit sketching about the individual that I am. So when he offered me a topic, how to keep a balance, I go, oh. And there was this... then he came up with something like the reckless pursuit of spiritual life. I said, well, maybe that's better, but anyway, I chose this one. The actual relationship between individuals. Spend much time on making the point that that we are not unique, and that we are, as human beings, taking advantage of the experience of others. Basically, a parental model works like that, and it continues in life. We have our mentors, and through these people, through the experience of others, we are going miles forward. If we would have to invent everything ourselves, take advantage of the experience of tradition. Yeah, if we would never take advantage of the experience of tradition, then obviously we would move very slowly in life. So man is not an isolated creature. We always live in a community. And yes, communities, they have their tradition, because man is also a creature of habit. That's a routine, and you can do it again and again. So routine makes you figure out a system, and then it becomes part of habit, and there you are.
So man is a creature of habit, a creature of systems that have been invented by others or by ourselves, and gradually these things, the way you slip on your shoes in the winter without opening the laces, you know, is just part of that. So tradition and culture is essential to human life. There are all kinds of cultures. If you want to join if you want to join Apple, you have to go through a whole process. It's a whole culture, or a cult sometimes they say. I had some friends who tried to work in an Apple store, and there was like they had to go to this 1 week seminar, and there were all kinds of activities there. They had to do dramas, they had to compose music, they had to show their creativity, they had to show so many features before they were selected or not. So there are all kinds of cultures in the world, all kinds of traditions in the world. And tradition is meant to bring out values in people. It's I saw in somewhere on a railway platform as I was waiting to catch a train, there was an African lady, and she had two kids and only me waiting on the railway platform. Then she bought a tub of ice cream, and one big tub, and she gave it to the kids. Two kids, and there's one tub of ice cream. You can imagine what's going to happen, you know. Like a major war started there, right? And so I was watching the whole thing, you know. And the kids are fighting, you know, over this ice cream. And so since I'm kind of a bit outgoing, you know, I said, don't mind if I ask you, but why did you buy one tub, you know, instead of two, right? I mean, she said, no, no, they have to learn how to share. And it was interesting. I thought it was really interesting. It's like a whole psychology behind it, you know, behind the tub of ice cream. The kids had to learn how to share. How there were values behind the tub of ice cream. So, any tradition is meant to teach such values, to make that part of a person's nature, his second nature. And so, in this way, these are the benefits of tradition. Tradition is also a place or a facility where knowledge is preserved. And that's also beneficial. So there are benefits to a tradition. On the other hand, traditions also tend to push people into a mold. Right? The tradition tells you what you have to be. And you know, say, well, do I have any choice? Is anybody going to ask me? I mean, like, how about my nature? How about who I really am? You know? And you're trying to force me into this tradition, and that's not me. So there's also a tension like that. Right? So now, when we come to spirituality, these same benefits and these same tensions arise. In spirituality, they sometimes say that organized religion is the death of the true religious spirit. Yeah? And I can relate to that. Hmm. There is the study of the sociology of religions was a study field started by Max Weber. And Max Weber came up with that among spiritual leaders, there are two extremes at the end of the spectrum. He said, one is the prophet and the other one is the priest, and they're on either end of the scale. And between the prophet and the priest, there's a tension. Because the priest is trying to maintain the tradition. The priest is trying to maintain the values, the institution, and the priest derives his status, his charisma, from the institution. The prophet, he's institutionally a hopeless case, because the prophet, he goes to work with the teachings, and then what the prophet does is he experiences with these teachings and gets his realizations and brings that back to the institution, and in that way the whole thing becomes, he revitalizes the teachings. Yeah. That is the prophet. He comes back and he brings new life to institution. They would like him to just toe the line, and the prophets don't like that. So in this way, prophet and priest are always a little bit at odds with one another. And yeah, personally, a more interesting personality to me, right? Someone who goes to work with whatever the tradition brought, and then just take it and works with it on his own, and his contribution becomes a renewal of the spiritual experience. So the spiritual experience, the spiritual realization, is the focus. So yeah, when you hear a talk from me on the individual and the tradition in a spiritual context, yes, then I'll put the emphasis on the prophet. What can I say? I think also the time we live in is more favoring the prophet than the priest. Right? If you look at the Middle Ages, it was clearly everything predominated by a spiritual institution. It was clearly dictated how to think. Yeah. And that's not only in Western culture, but that's also in Eastern culture. I found in the Rig Veda a text. Rig Veda is a very old Vedic scripture. And there's a text there that describes a sakka. A sakka means a branch. And it said a branch of a spiritual branch. And if you wanted to belong to this spiritual branch, it was not just about how you behaved. Yes, there was a standard of behavior that you had to follow to belong to that branch. But that was not all. There was a way you had to think. Right? Well, says the Dutch rebel in me. Never. You know, I mean, yeah. behavior, okay, sometimes we may be forced to conform our behavior to a degree, you know. But the way I think, you know, nobody gets in my head, type of rebellious nature. I think that's a little bit the spirit of the time, after, especially in the Western world. In the Western world, after centuries, after millennia of heavy institutional religion, we see more and more a trend towards spirituality. Right? It says the spirituality is exactly that. It is a now we find that spirituality may tap into traditions but doesn't commit to them. Right? Spirituality takes from traditions but does not ascribe to them. It kind of takes what is useful, and then spirituality is ultimately about the individual experience, and the individual experience is essential. That's where it comes to life. Otherwise, you'd say, well, it's just externally adhering to some tradition. That's not a great thing, right? Being a member of a club, right, or a member of a church, or a member of some sakha, a branch, that's not what it's about. I'm a member, yeah? Oh yeah, in that member, you know, playing the banjo. But no, one has to be the, in spirituality, it is about being alive in one's spiritual experience, and then with the essence. And then it doesn't matter whether it comes from this tradition, that tradition, or wherever it comes from, because ultimately it comes from you. And the traditions are simply there to kind of, as a catalyst, to bring it out. So that is kind of defining spirituality. So we can see that in this day and age, that's much more popular. Right? Now, I was, before I went into this thing of putting tradition versus, or religion versus spirituality, speaking about a tradition, and that within the tradition it is also possible to approach the tradition in a religious way or more in the spirit of spirituality. In other words, one may at one point think, yes, one particular tradition may come across as the most complete, most profound, most meaningful, and one may choose for that. But then within that, there are still different approaches. And tonight I would like to put the emphasis on the spirituality within tradition, and on the experience within tradition, on the prophet, and not on the priest, not on the one who gets his status from the church, from the dress, from the uniform, from the seat. Yes. Well, yes. Anything I wear is adding something to my identity, to my consciousness, you know. It's like, okay, type of glasses I wear, right? Anything, you know, any clothes, clothes, create a public image and a sense of self-identity, which is determining or at least reinforcing a particular type of behavior. And it's very powerful. So yes. The color saffron, I don't know if this is saffron, it's from a tin can, and whatever it is, you know, but supposed to imitate saffron. The color saffron is a color which, according to Vedic literature, stands for freedom. Yeah. It's a color that stands for freedom. So that's why I like it. It kinds of, it's set like blue, black. These are colors of ignorance, colors of go ahead. It's okay. Red stands for passion, right? And that. Anyway, so there are colors. There are places, energies in rooms. It's interesting that when people come into a space that they find their spot, right? And it's sort of like people have a particular, they have an attraction to a particular type of spot, you know, and instead they sort of go for that spot, and when the spot's already taken, they sort of look, you know, feel uncomfortable, you know, it's just like sort of look like, that's my spot, you know, what's this person doing in my spot, you know? Yeah, and it's amazing. And we always, in any space, we kind of go for that spot. It's relating a little bit to the doors, to this, to that, you know, various. We find our spot. It's like interesting. And in the Vedic culture, or in Chinese culture, you know, Chinese culture, you have the feng shui. In Vedic culture, you have vastu, and it's basically the same principles. Each spot has there's energies, there's values, there's like, and accordingly, like in the vastu, you sit when you need to study, right? And if you study in that spot, you'll study better. I have, honestly speaking, I haven't really experienced that. I read about it, I've tried it, I sat in the spot. It must have been very subtle, the influence, because it didn't really work so much on me. But maybe also, I lived for many years in an Indian place of pilgrimage. And then in 1995, that was like from the mid-70s to 95. And then that was over, that period in my life. And then since 95, I've been flying around the world, constantly flying. So I'm like living a life at a pace, you know, of like 250 to 300,000 air miles a year, which is like quite a lot, quite a pace. So that's why kind of New York feels like home, because people are moving in this place. So I can relate to that. Yeah, there's a high pace. So maybe that's one reason why I haven't been able to catch that energy of the Vastu because I'm moving too fast. But if you really sink into a place, really grow roots, you know, settle in, then maybe experience it different. Like a good friend of mine, a Swami in Sweden, he has a house like that. And it's a house, there's no electricity in the house. And in Sweden, that means something, you know, because it's like dark, for a long dark winter, no electricity. And he has his spot in the house where he studies and everything, spot, it's all allocated. And yeah, I think it works. One time he took a group of people, and I also went into the forest. And they took us deep into the forest, and then he took us to a tree, and then he said, "Now slow down." And I must admit, I instinctively moved towards the back of the crowd. Oh, God. Okay. It was already slow, you know. And it got like, now we're going to really slow down under this tree. I was like, sort of, whoosh, I slipped out. What to do? There are different natures. It is not required to put one nature over another. Spirituality is not stereotype. It's not that everyone has to become like totally frozen and sit in one place and just breathe in out for hours and then just now he's gone really deep. It's one approach. Another approach is spirituality on the move. That's also there. There's nothing wrong with that. The essence is to have the connection. Right? Whether we move or sit still, to keep the connection. Sitting still is a process to get the connection. That's what it's about. It's about making the connection. Yes. So the essence of all spiritual processes is to make the connection with spirit. What spirit is, that is another discussion. Different people from different traditions have a different perspective on that. Some think that ultimately the spiritual platform is a platform where, one sec, I have to look at the time, so every once in a while I tap my phone because I'm used to a watch and it conked out today and it's like really annoying.
Symbolism. Right? Now it's a little too. So mythology are often around the world. There's mythology, nice stories that explain natural phenomena. But I want to take it before I open it up to all of you for discussion. Personalities that have lived with the traditions. These are the prophets, the ones who've taken the tradition, went to work with it, went to live with it, and made it something real, right? Realized it, and we see the teachings manifest through them. You know, like when I, okay, talking, sticking for a moment with Francis of Assisi, through him, I developed faith in Christianity. You know, like, I mean, whereas if someone comes and here's the holy book and here's the Bible and do you believe in the Lord Jesus Christ? Oh, you know, are you ready to go to hell? Hell. then I'm going, well, Let me think about it. I don't know what else. I can't buy it like that. But when I look at this example of a great selfless personality, okay, now we can say, yeah, now there's something here. Okay. So today, I'm speaking from, it's a bhakti night. It was advertised like a bhakti night, and speaking from the bhakti culture. So now we have the great bhakti personalities, and there are also different prototypes. One is, you see some people, Sukadev Goswami. Sukadev Goswami did not want to have anything to do with the world. Sukadev Goswami followed a path consistently of just not doing it, just not conforming. I mean, totally not. Totally just being the individual that he was, and just from that platform connecting to the Absolute, who he understood as a person, as an individual, and seeing himself as an eternal individual. But his only interest was that individual connection with the Supreme. Nothing else. Nothing else. Sukadev Goswami didn't even put on clothes. Right? He didn't want to bother with clothes. Sukadev Goswami walked naked through the world. Sukadev just didn't follow any ritual. He didn't follow any routine. Right? It's like, you know, brushing those teeth again. Right? And that's the ritual starts. You know, early morning, brush those teeth. And what's next, right? And the day has kicked in, you know, the symbolic start of the day. And every day, the same old thing. God, as a man, the hair grew back, you know. God, what a trip it is, you know. Scrape, time for a new blade. I mean, and then, yeah, you can grow the beard, but then if it gets too big, it becomes very bushy. That's also, again, the whole thing. So, yeah, the rituals. So, Sukadev followed that path. That path attracts me. You know, the path of not getting entangled. I like it. Always did it, you know. Suits me. I am a high school dropout, 60s, 70s, what can I say, you know, hippie days, right? You know, just like, forget it, you know. Sleep on a cardboard box on the street in Venice. The police was very polite. Excuse me, you cannot sleep here. I'm very sorry. That's sweet. But it was nice. We lived that lifestyle. No money. Right? Go travel from Europe, from Amsterdam to India, without money, right? Don't do money. Just somehow or other go. Hitchhike, this way, that way, on a truck, on the roof of a bus, whatever way. Oh yes, Southern Europe is good, you know, for the orchard. Greece was great. There were people living off those orchards. Next to the peach orchard. And then all the way somehow. Of course, where money was needed, some money would, somehow or other, some money would come. Some hippies would give blood for money and then could get the deserved thing. Least of minimized involvement. It's still a little bit part of me. But that's not the only model in the Vedas. There are totally other models, right? There's the model of the person in the world who is working with the things of the world. iPhone. Working with the things of the world and connects the things of the world. Because after all, the things are not evil. It's what you do with them that's evil. Or not, you know, or good, right? It's what you do with the things. The knife could be unpleasant. Knife can take a life. Knife can save a life. It's the connection that counts. In this way. So in our tradition, Krishna, the Supreme Person, is the goal, the connections can be made by using the things of the world for spiritual purposes, and immediately it becomes spiritually elevating. Still, although I have this thing, right, because I live in this crazy world where everybody has a thing like that, and still it's an evil machine. Even if I use it for spiritual purposes, which I do, it's still an evil machine. It zaps me to begin with, and it does a lot more. And it subtly controls me. It's compulsive, and it's like... you also feel it. Kids grow up with phones. They never switch them off. The phone is always near. They feel insecure when it's not there. Guys, should we all together just go to the river, right? And all together, just throw them all in the water and liberate ourselves from slavery? Are these the new chains of slavery? And there's free Wi-Fi in New York. But one student of mathematics just figured out that there were algorithms in the free Wi-Fi code which do send your location to a central server. And the IP address of your phone. 1984, Big Brother. Anyway, you know, let's not get into conspiracy theories now, right? But should we all chuck them in the water all together? Could we do something less drastic than that? <It's> like, I'm waiting for the iPhone with lips. It's gonna come. Mark my words. Anyhow. I sometimes have these visions, you know. I don't know if I should go into this one. Maybe not, because time is running out. So save that one for later. But I hope to open it up for 15 minutes for a bit of discussion. Yes, please.
What was the vision?
I knew it. Vicious. Well, I had this dream, actually. Actually, what happened is I stayed in someone's apartment, and he was watching this program about genetic engineering. I had a dream that I was going into a supermarket, and there were these cabbages, and they were singing cabbages with faces, and they were singing, "Take us home, we're all alone. Take us home, we're all alone." And I tell you, I woke up sweating. I knew it was real. I knew it wasn't a dream. I knew it was real. Oh, voice from the sky. I knew that was actually.
Happens every now and then, you know.
Yeah. Yeah, scary. I mean, that dream was a nightmare. I'm sorry, that was, you may laugh, I know, but I tell you, that was, in case you didn't realize, take me home, we're all alone. That's a nightmare because it's coming. I tell you, the cabbages are coming. And, you know, I've given you two big tips tonight, you know, iPhones with lips, you know. And the cabbages are coming. And mark my words. Okay. Is that right? So anyone else, please? Yes.
I do have a question on the subject of the priest versus the prophet.
Yeah.
We see with the priests, they often are living a highly regulated down there, and they're following religious principles, which keeps like chaos at bay.
Right.
How does the prophet keep the chaos at bay?
Yeah, that's very true. So the regulation of the priest, right, who follows strictly a system, and versus the prophet, who may sometimes just venture out into his own experiences and may lose that regulation a little bit. Yeah, that's true. Therefore, everyone anchors into a tradition, both the priest and the prophet. It's interesting that spiritual traditions, right, that is like the Vedas, Islam, Christianity, you know, they all claim that they are not from man, that they come from, that they have a divine origin, right? And if that's true, then it makes sense that there is ultimately a link like that, and that then the tradition is an anchor, a spiritual anchor. Then it's no longer just a man-made thing, but it's actually a link with divinity and coming down from divinity. Then it has ultimately purity, even if in the tradition human beings would have put things on top, etc., but the core of it is from a divine origin. That balances the whole thing. Otherwise, yes, the prophet might be too much on the waves of his experience, his ecstasies and his whatever. But the tradition keeps him grounded. And the priest, because he's connected to the tradition, is also just going beyond externals and also gets internal realization. So it's not that the priest is just one who is only going the external path and gets stuck there. No, if he faithfully goes his external path, he can become deep, right, and realized. I mean, Even the Pope is deep and realized. You know, like he says sometimes really nice things that I like. Yeah. For example, the Pope said to a drug addict, he said, you may think that God is in the church. He said, but there you will not find him. He said, the place where you will find him is in your addiction. Now, that, you know, I take my head off for that one, you know. Put it back on. No, but that was good. That was deep. You know, I mean, I marked it and memorized it even. So prophet and priest can both have their realization. Maybe the Pope is a secret prophet these days. Anyway, so prophet and priest are both good. I'd rather be on the prophet side, though. It's more fun and more trendy also. So what do you like, the prophet or the priest? Who likes the priest and who likes the prophet? Okay, all those who like the priest. Priest.
I understand the...
One minute. First, no talking. You're just counting hands now. Please don't be shy. Because next I'm going to ask who's prophets, and if the hands are not going up, then you're not partaking. Yeah? You're on the priest's side.
I like both.
Okay. Both hands up then. You're the lot, the third category. Okay, so we had the prophets. So, see, prophets are popular then. Prophets? Okay. Yeah, lots of prophets. And who are both hands? Okay. And there's all the abstentions. Oh, God, the fence sitters. Come on, be bold. Be real. Don't be shy. Take a stand. Yeah. Whatever is the comfortable position for us. Both work. Me, I need my freedom. When I was 13, I got my first guitar and I couldn't play a chord. So I just played open on the strings and yelled out at the top of my lungs, freedom! And that's still deeply ingrained within me. I like my freedom. And so that's why, and maybe it was from last life, maybe that's why I took birth in the Netherlands, which is a country where freedom is held in the highest esteem. You know, it's at least a national ideal. Like the US, with all due respect to the US, is too regimented for me. I know, I've worked in this society which is very American, full of Americans. I've worked with Americans for so many years. God, they always want to create some sort of, you know, you have to conform to, this is how we conform to this. And I go, why? Why? You know? But whatever works, prophet and priest, both works as a way to go deeper into the tradition and to realize it ourselves. Without realizing the essence of a tradition, the tradition is simply external and one's belonging to it is on the surface and doesn't bring about the transformation that is the real goal of spiritual practice. If there's no transformation, what's the point of it? There has to be a transformation. What's the use of a tradition if it doesn't bring about a transformation? Like if you look at PhD, it's just a tradition. And it puts you through this whole thing. And when you come out, you've been transformed. Now, you will speak differently. Perhaps, possibly, then again. You know what I'm talking about. Yeah.
I have a question. When you say prophets, like I'm thinking of like people who have their own ideas and like their own revelations and things and have like a new way of, you know, of doing something. And like, do you know of any like real prophets, like opposed to like a false prophet? Because that's why I say I like the priest more than the prophet, because you know, like when you get into prophets, you get into people who like might say like they had a revelation.
Yeah, yeah. I'm talking within a tradition now.
Okay.
It's within the tradition. I'm not talking about the free form prophet. Yeah, I mean, I met God in Central Park, right? He's everywhere. He's all pervading. I met him in Central Park. He was. No, 1 minute. Marcus, let me tell my story. He was 64 years old, right? And had a tooth missing. But, you know, I said, well, my dear God, I've tried to dedicate my life to you all this time. And I never imagined that I would meet you here on a park bench. But here it is today. But fallen as I am, I still have some doubt in my heart. Dear God, could you please give me a sign? You know, he said, yeah, sure, what would you want? I said, well, the sun is pretty hot today. Could you make those trees on the other side of the path a little taller so we get some shade? He goes, what makes you think that God can do that? I said, well, isn't he almighty? He said, that's your definition. I said, then what is your definition? That God is a powerless, toothless old man on a park bench. Left him at that. I'm sorry, it was a little cutting. But
that's good.
Had to.
Was that Strawberry Fields?
Okay. That came from left field, all right?
That's in Central Park. I met a guy like that too.
Okay. Okay. Maybe. Yeah, please.
Thank you so much for the class. My question is just follows the last question. Okay, if we're talking about profit in the framework of tradition,
yeah,
what can makes us think that after the reform, it is the same tradition, actually.
Yeah, but at the same time, okay, the risk is there that the prophet might take it too far, and the priests will try and balance the prophet out. On the other hand, the priest may put too much emphasis on ritual, and may lose the deeper meaning of the actual religious experience, because there's not enough emphasis on the religious experience. Like in India, that is, for example, a big problem, that people in Indian families, they're told by their parents that they have to do things because the tradition is everything. So then when they ask why, and then the elder
you cannot ask that. That's offensive. How do you ask this?
Huh? And the younger generation is just not buying it anymore. You know, saying, look, you know, unless you can explain to us what are the benefits of these rituals. So the danger with priests is that it gets too ritualistic, too external, and losing the inner depth. The prophet then is bringing the renewed religious experience. So you need both. In a tradition needs both. the renewal of the prophet, of reconnecting us with the true religious experience, and the priest upholding the ritualistic practices, which ultimately are part of a process to bring out the realization. But obviously, if you have a prophet who disconnects himself from the religion, then he takes you off into the woods, you know. But a priest can just like kill you with all externals. So, and then there's a whole institution with like a lot of legislations, rules, prescription, all these things which are creating so many boundaries that which sometimes kill the individual expression. So there are issues on either side. Yeah?
You mentioned your buy-in being dependent on the people. And so why Krishna consciousness? What was it about the people that are part of this movement that grabbed you?
Yeah, well, I mean, first, first people of the past, great personalities of the past, right, impressed me. Because I'm not one, you know, I mean, yeah, the Hare Krishna movement in the West started in New York, went from New York to San Francisco and LA, and the next stop was Amsterdam, right? So it was really early in Amsterdam. And one day, these extraterrestrials appeared, you know, and I'm looking at them like, whoa. And when I saw them, they came out of a van, a gray van with a flap door, actually. So the door flapped open, and all these pink men came out. Too many. I tell you, too many for one van. So I'm looking at that van going, whoa, hey, what's happening here? Figured out, okay, what it was. But then I saw them in the street jumping up and down. It looked to me like the ultimate manifestation of religious fanaticism. I'd never seen anything as fanatic as that. So the immediate people around me was not exactly what attracted me. Rather, I kept a safe distance. But it was books that made me go deeper into the tradition, into teachings. And then when I began to find out about personalities from that were described in these books, then they were impressive characters, very impressive characters, and very interesting characters. So that sparked my interest. And then when I saw that the teacher, Prabhupada, you know, was such a personality, really embodied that same thing as the personality in the books, then it became really interesting, because then there was not only great personalities in the books, but there was a living prototype as well. So then you go, hey, now it gets something teachings that are consistent, that kind of make sense, personalities described that are amazing characters, and principles described that are amazing. For example, one little principle, I give just one example, otherwise it sounds so abstract. It says in Vedic literature, if an enemy comes to your home, you should treat him in such a way that he forgets his enmity. And that's beautiful. When I see that, I say, well, that's a principle which I can set that as an ideal in my life. So many things like that, so many principles, then people who lived it, and then in the present. This Krishna consciousness is asking for pure devotional service. It's not that you're doing this only a little and that that's the goal. No, you can do it a little and that's okay. You get your blessings, but it's not the goal. The goal is pure devotional service. Pure means 100%. So yeah, you know, like that non-compromised spirit, that sort of appeals to me. That made me believe in it, right? And then Prabhupada, he challenges. He's not just sweet, he challenges. He goes, so for these reasons, Krishna consciousness is true. Now, if you accept these reasons, then you have to change your life. Like that. So in this way, he forced me to take it. I didn't want to take it. Forget it. Why can't you take? Can I get involved in something a little less strange, a little less, kind of be just a little bit more mainstream? But he just challenged my integrity. And then I felt, at one point I felt, if I don't follow, his arguments were convincing. Now if I don't follow it, then I can never call myself sincere again. That's when I took it. Yeah, thank you too. Thank you all. Of your time. I think there are some people in the back there who are now, who usually come forward. Oh, yep. Come from that side. Here he is, our friendly host. He is the, let me just say 2 minutes. He is the, he's the brain of Lotus Room as a concept, right? And he's like filling it in and it's very nice to see what's happening. I just drop in every once in a while. I told you I'm flying. It's like I got dropped in by parachute here tonight. I have no idea where I am. But I think he has a vision, and I think it's a wise man. So we're happy to hear some closing words from Hari Vilas.
Thank you, Maharaj. So thank you guys for coming. A few announcements. This Saturday we have a nice program at the temple. It's a Saturday night kirtan. So once